It was a miracle that we survived.
It is so important for all of us to remember what happened during the Holocaust, to make sure that it happens never again, that we ensure the lessons of tolerance that can be drawn from that experience, and make sure that we in this country uphold our rights to practice our religions and to tolerate others in terms of their religious views.
And the only crime I and all our people committed was being Jewish.
A dwindling generation who lived through the darkest time in human history talks with us openly about the horrific experiences they suffered during the Nazi Holocaust. Our minds cannot comprehend the atrocities these people suffered at the hands of Adolf Hitler and his murderous thugs. And yet, they are survivors in the fullest definition of the word. Let us introduce you to 13 of the most amazing people we've ever met.
I was born on June 5th, 1935. I was born in Lithuania, Kovno. My father was an attorney, but because of the Nuremberg laws that were passed in Germany, all of Europe adopted those laws, and he could no longer practice law. Anybody that did not have 5 years of practical experience, such as doctors and lawyers, had to go back and work for the state at no cost. So he tried to find something to make a living with. He was an extremely skilled motorcycle racer. He used to race cross country. And because he was winning quite frequently, some people suggested to him that he go in the motorcycle business. And Lithuania was going to need motorcycles. They were an emerging country after World War I. So they suggested he go in the motorcycle business. Well, my mother was an exceptional salesman. The motorcycle was parked in our living room, and people used to come in our living room to see the motorcycle. And we sold, the first season, they sold 10 motorcycles, and the factory asked my father from buying one in one and selling 10 in a season was kind of unusual. They asked him to come to the factory so he could learn more and perhaps sell more motorcycles, and they would pay his expenses. So he happened to end up in Berlin the night of Kristallnacht, and he witnessed Kristallnacht in 1938 in Berlin.
Always I got a nice childhood and a nice family. We used to have our own house, playing soccer. We used to have a sweater factory. 13 or 15 people working.
I was born in 1940, 3 weeks before the invasion of the German forces into Belgium, in Antwerp. And the events were that we first fled with the invasion, with my mother carrying me, and then we were caught in Dunkirk between the British forces and the German forces and sent back into the cities till the German consolidated their power and controlled the cities and the population.
My mother and father divorced. My father lived in Czechoslovakia and we lived in Hungary. So when the school was over, my father used to come and pick me up, and in the whole summer, I stayed with him. And everybody said, "Oh, Mr. Alexander, you do that. How did you know? I look exactly like you. I look like my father. That's true." Yeah, so he was so proud he had a daughter.
I was born in eastern side of Poland, Krewo. Jewish people were a minority. It was Polish, it was Russian Orthodox, most of them, Polish Catholics, and Jewish people. We lived quite comfortable, I thought. My father had a shoe store and a leather store. We were 5 siblings. We had a sleeping maid in our house. We owned 2 homes. And life was not bad. We went to school every day. Twice a week we went to cheder. I don't know if you know what's a cheder. That's a Hebrew school for Jewish children.
I was born in 1927. I was born in Poland, in a city in southern Poland, southwestern Poland, called Sosnowiec. Wonderful childhood. We didn't live where I was born. We lived on the Baltic Sea in a port city called Gdynia, not very far from Gdańsk, before that Danzig. It was a lovely, I was the only child. My father was a newspaper man. My mother thought I was God, and I really enjoyed myself.
Okay, I was born in Poland, in Sosnowiec, July 27, 1928. But after the war, I took my mother's birthday, July the 8th, just to have to remember.
I was born in Poland, I was born December 4th, 1928, in Lodz, Poland. I came from a family of, there were three girls. I came from a very well-to-do family. We had a beautiful life, a very carefree life before the war. But when the Germans came in, our life changed drastically. Nothing was the same anymore after they came in. We had a beautiful home and they took everything away from us.
I had two brothers and two sisters, and one sister. We had four children. And we had a very nice, comfortable home and a business. And we were doing pretty good and, you know, nice living, very comfortable childhood.
I had a good life. I had toys, I had friends. I really didn't realize what was going on. The first time I realized what was happening is when Jews from Poland were escaping from Poland and the Germans, and our home was always open to strangers. They'd come and have a meal with us or whatever, and during the meal I would hear about some of the things that was happening in Poland. I was too young to realize what was going on.
In the city where I lived in Poland, up by the Baltic Sea, up north, there were very few Jews, almost no Hasidic Jews, Jews with beards. Nevertheless, being a Jew in Poland, in a Roman Catholic country, we knew we were Jewish. Although most of my friends were not. And you have to keep in mind that whatever anti-Semitism existed in Poland, there were no gas chambers, there were no crematoriums, there was anti-Semitism, but not threatening anti-Semitism.
During the Holocaust, 1,500,000 children lost their lives because of their family's religious or political beliefs. Many more were denied an education and had their freedom taken away. The Nazis treated Jewish children, even newborn infants, as they treated adults, as subhumans. Occasionally, children who had Aryan features were relocated to German families, who would erase all links from their previous lives. The remainder of the children shared the same fate as the adults. They would be sent to the ghettos and then to the camps, where they would be subjected to the same selection process. If they were too young or too weak to work, they were sent to their death. These were children from healthy, happy families, often wealthy, affluent, educated, contributing members of society. And still, Hitler deemed these people subhuman and not worthy of life.
Well, in 1939, in September, the war broke out. And, you know, all of a sudden, everything changed.
I don't like to talk about it.
Okay. Poland is going to be divided. East and West. Since I lived on the eastern side, the Russians invaded my side, on the eastern side. And on the western side, the The people who lived over there stayed under the Germans.
The Germans occupied our city. I remember the house, our house was on a hill, and they started to come up the hill. They came in their uniforms, and the first thing I remember as a child, I was 12, that, and they demanded, bring me some water, bring me some soap, you know, they were clean.
When they came in the beginning to Poland, we didn't know what will happen.
I think I was very young those days, naturally. And I heard that the Jews that time didn't take certain places. Yeah. For instance, for this more elegant cafe house, that was a sign, no Jews permitted. So it got worse and worse, and it spread it, the same idea, further and further. And then when the German came, they took all the Jews to Germany in a concentration camp, and there was we are staying.
Well, it's a very short story, but a sad one. They took us from, at that time it was Hungarian, from Besterce. They took us to Auschwitz. And there they divided us, woman here and man on this line. And that's the last time I saw my father. I looked to see if I can see him between the man and the lines. And then he was crying. And I said to myself, I think he's crying because he knows that's the last time he's going to see me. And that's what it was.
We were in Lodz, we left Lodz, because Lodz was enclosed into a German Reich. So right away, it was not easy to live in a big city like Lodz. Since we had family in a small town, Żarno, which was about, I would say, 20 miles out of Lodz. And my father suggested we should leave Lodz because it was very hard to get food. The stores were closed and the schools were closed. Everything was closed, especially for the Jewish people. So my father suggested that we should leave Lodz and go to Żarno, which is a very small town where my grandparents lived, my mother's family lived there. And of course, living in an area that is close to the farmers, it was much easier because you had access to food.
The order came that all the Jews from outside the ghetto should move into the ghetto. That was for protection against the Lithuanians. When the Russians were driven out of Lithuania and before the Germans came in, our Lithuanian neighbors started killing the Jews in the street. They dragged them to a service station known as Lituka's Garage. They beat them to the ground. And after they were helpless, they filled some of them with water until they almost burst and then took gasoline and doused them with it and set them ablaze. Shortly after that big massacre, the Germans came in and they said they were going to establish peace between us and the Lithuanians. And to do that, they were going to put us inside of a ghetto, which was enclosed by barbed wire, to keep us safe and to keep them out. That's not exactly the way it happened, but that was the excuse. And the Jews were overjoyed. They quickly started building a ghetto so that everybody could move in. And the Jews living outside of that segregated area had to relocate and find themselves housing.
My father put me on a wagon with all our furniture and a lot of our belongings. There were like three or four wagons. And on the way, they stopped us, the Germans stopped us and confiscated everything. When I arrived in Żarno, we had nothing, and it was very devastating. My father was so heartbroken that it happened.
In 1942, we tried to escape to what was called France Libre, which was essentially under Vichy control. And there we were caught again and put in another camp in Annecy, my mother and I.
It was a different environment altogether. First of all, I remember, because I was so young, that they took away the business from us. There was no private industry. We were allowed to stay in our home, but it was mandatory that those people who ran away from the western side, from the Germans, that we take in. Every family had to take in other people who ran away from the German side.
And that time they was working in a special place there, like a munition factory there. They're using us, really.
There was no cars, just one man had a car. He was a doctor. And most of us, we had bicycles. Or to go to another city, we went by a bus. And I thought, till 1939, that our life was quite good.
A ghetto was erected in Lodz in 1940, and many, many people perished. But when we were in the smaller town, Żarnów was a little bit easier. My father was a very brilliant man, and I think that because of him, we survived. He was brilliant, he was bright, he was highly respected, he was educated, and he could foresee. That man had a foresight, an insight, just incredible. Because we were three of us, and everyone survived because of his foresight and insight.
A week before the German came, I was drafted to the Russian army. Because I was on the Russian side, but never made it, you know.
Ghetto was on one side, and the other side was a sawmill. We volunteered to go to the sawmill, me and the brother. When the Germans took the big trees from the woods, cut them in the sawmill, they took everything to Germany. I trade in for the farmers, you know, where they put in the wood, trade in, you know, something, blankets, anything, just to get something to eat. So I trade with the farmer, I give him a blanket, he bought me a loaf of bread. And I was working daytime, and the brother was working nighttime. So if you got something to trade, so I throw a little rock, told them it's a little opening that you put over there, the bread, anything, just to eat. So SS came out from the ramp. He said, "Where did you get the bread?" I said, "I find him here." And he got a gun at my head. I was lucky the SS, who was in charge in the sawmill, he said, "What are you doing here? The sawmill is waiting for you." So he hit me so hard with his boot, shoe. Thank God the SS didn't kill me.
They came with tanks and trucks, and they were occupying the whole city. All the businesses were closed. It was very scary. You couldn't go out. We thought, you know, the Germans, the cultural people, they won't bother the civilians. So they said, what can they do to us? We'll wait out the war and then it will pass. Well, meanwhile, after a month or 5 weeks, one afternoon, they came, they started to knock at the doors, the Jewish homes, and officers came, German officers, get together a few things, you are leaving. Half Poland went to Russian and half Poland went to the Germans. We happened to be on the German side. We went to the bridge, and on the bridge was written, you're going to Palestine. They were teasing us.
There was no food under the Russians. We had to stay in a line. We continued to go to school, but schooling consisted of how great Stalin is, how great Russia is, and they will conquer the whole world. That's what I remember. But we are not allowed to go to any synagogue. And no Hebrew classes, the cheder, what I told you before, that we went for.
The very first house inside of the ghetto was that of my grandparents, my mother's parents. It was a three-room house that was built for a family of five. 16 of us ended up living in it. It didn't even have a bathroom or running water. The bathroom was an outhouse in the back of the yard. Water was brought in from a well. Electricity was available for a couple of hours a day, and when the electricity was shut off, we used to use a carbide lantern. One morning, by 6 a.m. in 1941, they had all of us come out to a place known as Democratic Square, Democratic Field. It was a huge field inside the ghetto. We stood in front of a German sergeant, and he asked everybody, "Was ist dein Beruf? What is your profession?" My father, till his dying day, didn't know why. He died 6 years ago. He didn't know why, but he told them that he was a car mechanic. My father knew nothing about fixing a vehicle. He used to ride motorcycles, but he never fixed them. He had friends that were mechanics that used to work on his machine. He couldn't drive it nail straight. But he told them he was a car mechanic. And when he told them that, they told us all to go home. And that saved us the night that they took 10,500 men, women, and children and sent them to their death. The next morning, a German with a rifle came, knocked on the door, said he was looking for the car mechanic. My whole family, everybody started crying because they knew there was no car mechanic there. Either all of us would be executed or my father would for lying. My father spoke seven languages, amongst them German fluently. He stepped forward and he said he was the car mechanic. The German told him, come with him. They took him to one of those hangars and the German told him that he had a broken vehicle, could he fix it? My father said, certainly in German, no problem. I can fix it. So the German said, how long will it take? My father said, a couple of days. Figuring that in a couple of days, he would go back into the ghetto, ask his friends that were mechanics how to fix it. The German said, I don't have a couple of days, you fix it now. So my father said, well, what seems to be the problem? The German said, you're the mechanic, you tell me. When I drive it, there's a banging underneath my seat. My father said, I tell you what, I'm gonna lay down on the ground, you drive over top of me, and I'll look underneath and see if I can see what's causing the problem. My father lay down on the ground, the German drove over top of him, and my father realized that the universal joint was hung, and every time it made a revolution, instead of doing it smoothly, it used to hit under the seat. He told the German, I see where the problem is, I will fix it for you. Now, my father didn't know what kind of tools to ask for. He'd never done anything like this before, so he went to the tool room and said, give me an adjustable wrench and a screwdriver. With an adjustable wrench, a screwdriver, and his bare hands, because he was so scared, in those days, universal joints used to be bolted together. He unbolted the universal joint, being a lawyer, he put everything in chronological order, took the biggest piece, went to the parts room, and said, give me one of these. And the guys realized that he was in trouble. They gave him a universal joint with the proper tools. He put everything back together. And when he did, he went to the German and said, I've got it fixed. Would you like to try it? The German got in the vehicle, drove it a couple of blocks, came back, said, it's perfect. You're the finest mechanic I've ever seen. You will now be the shop foreman. And here is a loaf of bread and some butter for you. My father refused the bread because prior to that, there was a young man by the name of Mac. He was 18 years old. He was trying to smuggle in a loaf of bread through the ghetto gate for his ailing mother. The Germans caught him with it because they searched everybody going in and out. They caught him. They took him to the same field where we were selected, Democratic Square. They built a gallows and they hung him. And everybody, including me, I was 7.5 years old at the time, had to see the hanging. My father knew of that hanging, so he told the German he couldn't accept the bread because they will kill him. The German told him, get inside the vehicle. And when he got inside the vehicle, he drove him back through the ghetto gate right to our house, walked into our house, and that night we had an extra ration of bread and some butter.
A ghetto is an area within a city that the Nazis enclosed with barbed wire or walls. They moved all the Jewish people from the surrounding countryside into the ghetto. Food rations were poor and living conditions unbearable. The overcrowding bred disease and starvation. The Nazis, being the engineers of genocide, designed concentration camps to speed up the process of death for the people they proclaimed less than human.
It was a whole lot of memories in the Maline there. The way they start building and everything has to be hiding, that people shouldn't see the way they were building. They were thinking just one thing, to get free. We felt that we will never get out free and to breathe, you know, the fresh air. But it was horrible. What could you think? You felt one thing, how to get out and to be free, like a bird.
There was no light underground, and there was not enough oxygen to even keep a match lit. The family had run a pipe into the ground and concealed it by placing a dog's kennel over it. This provided just enough air for the family to breathe. The potato hole was full of field mice and lice, and the family did not have a bath or a change of clothes during their 9 month stay in hiding. Their only means of relieving themselves was a bucket placed in the corner.
It was very bad off.
While my father was working at the airport, he met a farmer that he had done some legal work for when he was still allowed to practice law. The farmer told him that they were killing the children in the Warsaw ghetto, and if he could get me out of the ghetto, he would try to save my life. We had discussed it, but before we had an opportunity to do anything about it, the Germans again raided the ghetto. This time they were looking for 550 Jews to be deported from Kovno, Lithuania to Riga, Latvia. They started grabbing Jews off of the street, and when they didn't have the quota, they started going house to house. They came to our house. My mother was recovering from a beating she had gotten because she wasn't loading coal fast enough. A German hit her with a rifle butt and she required some stitches. So she was home recovering and her parents were home from shift change. They came to our house. They grabbed mother and me. They grabbed my grandparents, two uncles, and an aunt while standing in line to be loaded on a truck. A Jewish policeman that was a friend of my father's recognized me, grabbed me, pulled me out of line, said, "You don't belong here. You and your mother go home, your father will be waiting for you." My mother wanted to go with her family, but I wanted to go to my father. So I told her, "I want to go to Dad." And she said, "Well, we need to go." And the policeman told my mother, "Get out of line, you will catch up to the family at a later time, you go home." I started crying, I yanked her out of line. Mother and I are the only two that survived from the 550 that were deported that day, including her parents. Two brothers and a sister were all executed.
We lost already everybody from the family. I didn't have nobody left over. Everybody went to concentration camps. I was in a concentration camp, but the other was tough, rough. Nobody could survive from that place.
We went home, and shortly thereafter, my father made arrangements for us to escape. And in the middle of the night, my father cut the barbed wire fence that was near his cousin's house. There was a bridge there. And I was told to go through the fence and hide in a yard across the street. No matter what I saw or what I heard, was I to make a sound. So when we could no longer hear the footsteps of the hobnailed shoes on the cobblestones, I ran out and hid across the street. The guard made a second path, and after he made his second path and we could no longer hear his footsteps, my mother came out. And by touching the ground, she touched me, and not a word passed between us. On the third path, my father came out and likewise joined us. My father's cousin, who lived near the fence where we had cut the hole, took and hooked the barbed wires back so the Germans wouldn't know that we had escaped. We walked about five blocks to where my father had made arrangements with the farmer that I told you about. He was there with a wagon full of straw. I was hidden under the straw, wrapped in a down blanket, which, by the way, I still have. And my mother sat next to the farmer with a scarf over her face so her features wouldn't be recognizable. And my father walked the team. They went that way for about 40 kilometers when we got to Trakai. In Trakai, we went to a Polish Catholic farmer. They were so poor, he had a one-room house with a dirt floor, a wooden table, a wooden bed with a straw mattress where the farmer, his wife, and 16-year-old son used to live, sleep. There was no chimney on the fireplace that they had, so whenever she cooked, the whole house filled up with smoke. There was only one window, and even the sheep were kept in the small house to keep them from freezing after she cut the wool off of them. And they offered us refuge. We had nothing to give them. They asked for nothing because they felt it was the right thing to do. My father knew it was dangerous for us to be there, so he asked the farmer if he could dig a hiding place under his potato field in the woods from a potato hole. The farmer told him that he could. Well, my father wasn't an engineer, he wasn't a mechanic. He didn't know that if you dig underground, you've got to shore it up or something. Well, in the middle of the night is the only time he could go out to dig, and the farmer's dog, Rexy, used to go with my father. When he one night with Rex, he went out there to dig, and the whole place came tumbling down on him. It caved in. Rex tried to dig my father out, but couldn't, so he started barking and running around in circles. The farmer's 16-year-old son, Stashuk, was coming back from a hoedown. He used to play fiddle. He was coming back and he heard the ruckus from the dog, so he came running because he realized something was wrong or the dog wouldn't act that way. When he got there, he saw a hand sticking out from underneath the ground. That's all he could see. He quickly opened up my father's face so he could breathe, went and got his parents, and the three of them dug my father out, saving his life.
You know, we were living in a cave. And by being over there, at the cave, we couldn't go out, not day and at night. And we was, I don't know how many people, I think about 12 or more, was hiding in the same place.
From the surface, you could not see it. All you could see was the potato hole. From the potato hole was a long 20-some foot tunnel. And from the tunnel opened up into an underground chamber, and then there was another escape tunnel that led to another potato hole. During the daylight hours, I could come out onto the bottom of the potato hole. Couldn't come out. By the bottom of the potato hole, you could see daylight. So I'd stay at the bottom of the potato hole, peel off my shirt, and try to find the lice that were crawling on me and pop them between my two thumbs, thumbnails. Figuring that every time I popped one, it was less they would bite on me, and I counted. So the whole idea was to get more every day than I did the day before. They multiplied rapidly, and that's how I learned how to count.
Other hiding places have been well documented. For example, Anna Frank and her family. Meet two brave women who at a very young age hid in the open.
We did hear that they were rounding up Jews instead of in concentration camp, and people were afraid, they were talking about it, but nobody did anything about it. So my father was one of the first people, I am not going to send my children to slaughter. So my father contacted some Polish people and gave him some money to make false papers for us. And he was very disappointed because when he gave him the money, and then when he came actually to get the false papers, they never showed up. But then one day, one of the women, they used to come every week to our house. Our house was like a cabin. And we in that cabin, all of us lived. My father, my mother, all three of us. And my father was cooking soap there because he knew how to cook soap. So he was making soap. You were helping him. And on the weekends, the farmers would come, would buy the soap and exchange for food. So one of the, there was a woman, what you call a righteous Gentile. She used to come to visit us and, you know, buy soap. And used to bring us all different, you know, like grits and potatoes and whatever. And she says, you know, they are killing Jews. And they're sending from here now. There was already like 1943 or 44. You know, the dates are not here. But I know there was already late. And when they rounded up the Jews, the radio, they went to concentration camp. I'll take your daughters to Warsaw. I'm not going to say anything to my mother. But I take him to Warsaw. At that time, my father had no money. She did it of the goodness of her heart. She was such a wonderful woman. I remember like now when she came to get us, pick us up, my sister and myself, it was like in September. She refused to take my middle sister because she was a very nervous type and she was afraid that she might give herself away. So she only took my older sister, Unsi, and I was the baby, the two of us. And I remember when she came to pick us up, and this I'll never forget it, when I said goodbye to my father, because I knew my mother, I knew I'll never see him again. That was the most thing that I the most, you know, when I think about it, because I love my parents so much, especially my father, because he was a father, he was a mother, he was such a sophisticated man and so brilliant and wonderful. And he took me, everyone separate, he took me before we left. He said, I want you to know, I want to teach you how to survive. And he was walking with me for about 45 minutes before the woman came in. He said to me, my papers were, my name was Wanda Kazusek. He said, remember one thing, don't never reveal your identity, no matter what happens. Never tell them who you are and never trust a Pole. He knew how they were. That's why so many Jews died in Poland because they actually helped the Germans. He says to me, never reveal your identity to anybody. And to, when he told me that, it was so holy in my mind that, that even after the war, I didn't want to tell him that I was Jewish. In 1942, when they came to our city and they told us that our city is going to be resettled. But my father, he's in heaven with my mother, he says, no, they're not resettling us, they're putting us to die. And I'm going to do everything in my power that my children want. How do you survive? The only way to survive, that you know, when you have blue eyes and blonde hair, you can, you know, when you get, live in our soon name. And when she picked us up and took us with her on the train, and I was so scared, we could see the soldiers going back and forth and looking at everybody's faces, and you know, by looking, because you knew that you were guilty. I thought they're coming after me, my heart was beating. I thought, they're gonna now kill me here, they're gonna take me here, but they're walking back and forth, looking at people's faces, and they would never stop around me. She took us to her mother, and we stayed with her for about, I would say, I don't know, maybe, she probably knows better the timing, my sister remembers better, because she's older 4 years than I am, and at that time, 4 years was a lot. When I was 15, 14, she was 18. Anyway, so she finally arrived in Warsaw. We stayed with this woman, and everything was fine until my younger sister came, my middle sister came. When that lady came to us, and she brought us the birth certificate, she told my mother and father, she says, no, I'm not, I can't give her this certificate because she looks very Jewish. And she wouldn't give her no certificate, just myself and my younger sister. And then when I, the last time, when she came to us, I knew deep down in my heart that I'm never gonna see my parents again. They sacrificed their lives for us. So people around begin to be very suspicious. He said, these women must be Jews. What are you doing here? Why would you be here? Where's your father? Where's your mother? You're young. Why aren't you with your parents? And you know what they did? They went, they told us, if you're not gonna get the hell out of here, we're gonna go to the Gestapo report on you. These guys. So my sister said, she said, you know what? It's time for us to, we have to split. Because if you stay, the three of us together, we arose too much suspicion. People keep on looking. Being alone is different. So she said, we all have to leave. Everybody's gonna be on their own. My parents didn't have no place to go, no place to turn. And they were walking in a forest. The whole, without food, nothing. And I believe in miracles, there was a miracle, because while they were walking in that forest, they found a lady who I knew from our town, and he approached her. He says, I beg of you, why can't you take Nana? My sister, Nana, where are you going? She says, I'm going to Warsaw. And would you take her? And she did take her, and he gave her the address, and she came to, and when we were sitting in Warsaw already, five of us in one small place, and the lady was poor anyway. She came in, knocked at the door, and she told us what happened, that my parents perished, they all perished.
I went to a train station, and it was already in the evening, and I was keeping looking at people's faces, who looks, not that sophisticated, someone that looks very poor. And I approached this woman, and I said to her, I'm Wanda Kazusek, I have some papers to go to Germany to work. Because the German was sending papers to Poles, not to the Jews, to go to Germany to work. Because when the war broke out between Germany and Russia, see, a lot of Germans were going to the front to Russia. They needed the workforce. So I said, well, I got papers and I don't want to go to Germany. So she said, listen, honey, Banda, I'll take you to my house just for a little bit, she says, because I'm a very poor woman with a son, for about 2 weeks, and then from then on, you gotta be on your own. So I stayed with her for 2 weeks, and I have to tell you, I was starving there.
Being the oldest, I had to take responsibility for my sisters. My sister who was here, she had a job next to the ghetto, and my other sister, Nana, she was working for a policeman. She was always suspicious of her. And what he did, he abused, sexually abused, abusing her.
I work for these people. They are very wealthy people. They just got married. The man works for the Germans. He's a Pole, works for the Germans. And they're looking for a maid. And they live right next to the ghetto, the Jewish ghetto.
She says, you can get the job. You just go there. And the woman is going to interview you. I went over there. I see a woman, absolutely stunning, about 5'8", gorgeous. I never forget it. You know, I was only 15, and I was so impressed with the beautiful nails and slim and gorgeous. She says to me, what's your name? I said, my name is Vanda. What's your second name? My name is Kazusek. She says, well, did you ever do housework before? I said, yeah, I did some housework. She says, well, would you be able to work for me? I said, I'll do anything for you. And she says, well, I have a dog. Can you take care of the dog too? I said, I'll do anything. And she hired me on the spot.
I went on a train station and I approached the lady and I said, where are you going? She says, I'm going to Miłosna. I said, Miłosna, that sounds good. And my father was making soap at the factory of soap. I even remember the name, Polska Wytwórnia Meblarska. I told that lady, she looked to be a nice lady, and I said, you know, I can teach you how to make soap. She said, really? And when she told me, she goes to Miłosna, I was listening very carefully what she was telling. I came in the train, and when the guy said, Miłosna, I ran out. What do you think? She would disappear. She was not no more. Forget it. She changed her mind. It was around Christmas time. I was walking from one place to another. And I said, I beg of you, I said, I have no place to go, no place. Would you have mercy on me? I'm going to sleep on the floor. Just give me some shelter. I was going from one place to another and to another. I was beside myself. I was so, you know, I was scared to death. And I was, I was freezing. I was cold. I didn't have too much clothes on me. But another miracle happened. Finally, I see a little store. I opened the door from the store, and I opened the door, and I didn't speak. I crossed myself. I said, Jesus, I was wearing a big cross. Jesus Christ, I said, have mercy on me. I knew every prayer. I was a devout Catholic. She said, I beg of you. I said, it's Christmas time. I'm going to do everything for you. I beg of you. I said, Jesus Christ is going to be good to you. I said, you're going to help me. That lady was like an angel. So one day I come from the shopping and I open my door. There was a very long corridor. I open the door and there stays a German in German uniform and another man in a trench coat with a gun in his hand sticking to my back. He says, you come here in the living room with me, in Polish to me. Sit down. You are a Jew. I said, a Jew? I'm not a Jew. You know what? When I was going shopping one day, there was a woman about 40 years old recognized me when I was to work for my grandparents. That was my grandparents at the time. You know, in the little village, she recognized me one day in the street and she followed me. Where I was living, and went to Gestapo and reported me. What did she have against me? I was just a little girl, 14, 15 years old. She was an older woman and she went and reported to Gestapo. There's a Jew there. I know her. Can you believe this? So the guy said to him just like that. The Pole was interrogate me. He says, what's your name, real quick? My name is Vanda. What's your second name? Kazusek. You have a father, you have a mother. He, you know, knew all that. Do you know how to pray? I said, I know how to pray. You go to church? I said, I'll go to church. He said, well, when you go to church, what do you do? I said, I pray. But have you ever been to communion? I didn't know. I said, yeah. Well, what do you do when you go to the communion? I said, well, I didn't know. And I said, does he give you anything to eat? Does he give you anything to drink? I didn't say anything. Does he give you wine? You know, yes. When he heard this, he said, get up. You go with me to the German Kommandantur office, and you know what's going to happen to you. You're a Jew. You're going to be shot immediately, he said to me. Then I start crying because I knew this is the end. But while he was interrogating me, this German officer was talking to her She was sitting next, and she still was wearing a robe, a very impressive-looking woman, and he was very impressed with her. While he was interrogating me, when he said, get dressed, you're going with me, she says, wait a minute. I know this child. She's been working here for 2 years. I know her mother. I know her father. See, my sister used to write letters to me, pretending that she's my mother, and I used to send her, show her the letters. He says, I know that child. I said, she's so mixed up, she's so scared, she doesn't know what she's doing. She took off all her jewelry.
and put them on the table. She says, this is my Colorado. That child is not Jewish. You know, they believed her because they thought, you know, why would she? Especially when any goy, that any non-Jew that was keeping a Jew was shot. Mm-hmm. So they thought there couldn't be. You have to go with me. I took her to Mrs. Piasecka, and she was a sweetheart. She stayed, she let her stay with me a little bit for a few days, but I said, it's a war, and it was not a miracle. We walked, and she was, Nana was so upset. What are we going to do? The Poles used to recognize her. She was, I don't know, she gets a tremendous, fearful look, and people used to recognize, the Poles used to recognize her. And it was like one of the greatest miracles. We walk in Warsaw, and I see a tremendous sign, Jedz z nami do Niemiec, what means in Polish, go with us to Germany. I said, Nana, this is a chance of a lifetime. And I pushed her in with all my might. And she walked in, thank God. She walked out, she embraced me, and she survived in Germany as a Pole. But, not, you know, she survived, thank God. But I don't think she ever get over the Holocaust. She's, right now, she lives in Toronto, Canada. Every single day, when someone knocked at the door, I thought that's coming after me. I lived in such a fear. My sister said to me, you know what? You must leave this place. They're going to get you. I said, you know, I have no place to live. Go. I have no place to go. I am staying. And I was at night, I would wake up and I would talk to my father. He said, what do you think I should do? Shall I stay? And I said, no, I'm going to stay. And you know what? They never came. They never came. But one day when the Jews made the uprising, and then I'm going to finish, when they made the uprising in the ghetto, so the Germans came in, they knew that the Jews are fighting, so they came and burned the whole ghetto, and they knew that a lot of people were hiding in the basement, so they dynamite the whole basement. Oh yeah, and all night long you could hear crying and screaming and weeping, and everybody, all the Poles were outside standing, wanted to know what's happening. If the flame is going to hit our house. They were not afraid. They're not crying because of the Jews. Because they were afraid that the flame. So I was standing outside. My husband, they were just like two guards. So handsome, those two people. Her husband and her. And they're very aristocratic people. Anyway, she always said, Wanda, I'm going to send you up to the war. You're going to go to school because you're very intelligent. I'm going to send you to school. She said, tell that to me. But anyway, so we're standing outside, you hear this? And I start crying. I said, because I hear the crying, these kids, children, the weeping. I said, Wanda, why are you crying? I said, because I feel so sorry for these people that are dying there. She put her hand on my shoulder. I'll never forget it. She says, Wanda, I feel sorry for them as human beings, but as Jews, let them burn. Oh. So help me God. When she said, that's why I could never forget them. I thought to myself, all this time I thought that maybe deep inside the woman knew that I was Jewish. She kept me because of the goodness of her heart. No. But to hear this from her, I love this woman. I love this woman because she was good to me. She was everything that I wanted to be. And something died there. Something just died there. Because I was so shocked. You know, at 15, you hear somebody say something so powerful. Let them know. What did she have against the Jews? I am telling you, this happened so many years ago, and I could never forget it.
Those few who found a hiding place were resourceful and lucky, comparatively speaking. 6 million Jews, men, women, and children, were not, and perished in the death camps.
Well, much top of 100 feet or so, a German SS on Mengele, standing there with a pencil in his hand, one hand in his uniform and one pencil, pointing the left, the right. I had my younger brother with me, so I held on to him. He points me to the right. When I point you to the right, you better go.
I was in the ghetto Pruszana, which was in eastern Poland. And one day we were told to come out in the morning with a little package on the marketplace. And we were put on a horse and wagon and taken away somewhere to a railroad station. We didn't know where we were going because they never tell you where you're going. And from there they put us on a train, you know, cattle cars. And we went to Birkenau and Auschwitz, if you heard of those places. And Auschwitz, where I got the number here.
They give us different clothes. And then they put us up in a camp where it was full till the top. There's no place to move because so many people came, they had no room to everybody. So they put us in one room as much as possible. That wasn't convenient.
I remember very clearly, I was about 2 years old, and I was a detention camp for before being deported, essentially, of women and children. And I was standing outside, and Annecy is on like on a mountain, and I could see a car coming to the path, and I can still see it today, coming up the mountain. And something in that car made me stand and look. Took my attention. And as a two-year-old, after, you know, couple of minutes, I stopped looking. And about 10 minutes later, that car pulled into the yard, and three German officers came out. I can still see the buttons on their coats. And they walked in to where the women were. And that's the details I know only from my mother. They went up where the women were working in the kitchen. And when two of the soldiers turned to close the two doors, my mother escaped from the back door.
We knew there's not going to be in a picnic. We knew it's going to be rough, but didn't believe that they have death on their mind.
They came to our house knocking on the door, and my father says to us not to open the door. But the soldiers broke in the door, and my father ran away to the back door, and he was beaten up, unbelievable, and they brought him back. After a very short while, they put us in a ghetto. You know what's a ghetto? We go to a ghetto, we take our father, but he was so beaten up, and so he was a young man, he was maybe 37, 38, and he died in ghetto. He died in ghetto. We stayed in ghetto for a very short while, and we were ordered to leave the ghetto. As long as we are going to obey orders, nothing will happen to us. And they tell us to walk. My sister, next to the oldest one, she was running to the forest because we had a lot of forest, and she had a boyfriend, and she was shot on the spot, and the boyfriend was shot on the spot. And we continued to walk, but a lot of people, by walking, a lot of people died. And we were made, whoever was still able to dig ditches and throw in the dead people, they wanted to cover up that nobody should see that so many people were dying, and some of them were shot. The Nazis had big dogs. They had dogs and sticks and guns. Some of them who couldn't walk, they were shot. So anyway, my first concentration camp was Pleskau. When I come to Pleskau, I'm still with my mother. First of all, they ordered us to take off the clothes. When we leave the ghetto, my mother, we had some gold pieces, but she sewed in the clothes that she says, maybe we'll need a piece of bread or something, we'll be able to buy something, because we didn't know that something like that can happen. But we were ordered to take off the clothes. Everything stripped us naked and gave us blue and white pants, the stripes, and big shirts, and our heads were shaved. And we were in Pleskau, I don't remember how long. But since Pleskau, I was in six concentration camps.
He said, you're not a bricklayer. I said, I didn't work in my profession for 2-3 years, so I'm slow. He got a gun again. He said, I'll tell you what, if you're not a bricklayer, I'll go find out in a week or two, I'll go kill you. I said, yes, sir. Finally, somebody told me that he's watching far away. I was broken out. He said, you go live, you're a bricklayer.
Life was broke out. People were dying. People were committing suicide.
I started to work. I never finished grade school. And that was the end of my education until I came to America. No high school, no grade school. Every Jewish child had to work from the age of 13. And I worked in a number of places. And eventually I worked for the SS in the ghetto of Zawiercie. And the SS role there was to resettle Germans, not Reichsdeutsche, but Volksdeutsche, people who were German in the 18th century and resettled in Russia, and now they were being brought back to that part of Poland, which was annexed to Germany. So I worked there as an interpreter until 1943. The ghetto was liquidated and we were sent to Auschwitz.
I was in three camps, in Ginterbrücke, Klettendorf, and Ludwigsdorf. But in 1943, this was the last Aussiedlung, I don't know how to say it in English. They sent the last people out from Poland, the last Jews. And I went with this transport, and my mother was with my brother, and she didn't want to leave my brother. So I guessed them. And my father was shot. It was very bad. It was like we were in hell. Excuse my English.
So you work from morning till night, wherever they send you. All kind of works, you know, garden, railroad, building railroad, tearing down a hill on the side, and filling the hole in that, and then put railroad tracks. We used to be moved every other day.
To a place that was lit up like a Christmas tree. Electric wires. It looked like a big factory. It was Birkenau.
I got typhus fever. And I just heard a lot of noise. And I couldn't keep my balance. So a guy was carrying me. My friends said they... because they detect that you're sick or something, they just kill you or gas you. So they took me to work and I kept falling, so they sent me back to the barracks, and there were bunk beds, but they only got room for one shift of people, 12 hours. If those went to work, those came back, and I couldn't find a bunk to lay down, and every bunk was 3 or 4 people. I had a pair of wooden shoes, and the shoes were falling off, so I got a belt and I got a little half a razor blade, so I cut the belt and put the strips there, so I got left here half a belt. So I decided to commit suicide, because a day before there was a guy die, and one of the Germans, I think he already got, they got some old officers to watch the camp. He kept kicking him, and he says, come on, lazy Jew, get up and go to work. And he was dead. So I got the imagination that I'd be dead, and he'd be kicking me. I ain't coming no place. So I went and took that around my throat, climbed up, and I jumped, and I passed out. All of a sudden, I woke up on the floor, and the guy who was carrying me, I always gave him my portion of bread. He said, come on, you're going to miss your bread. Bread portion, you know, that's what saved my life. I couldn't get up, so he finally left. So I got a little metal box, and I got a half a razor blade and a few cigarette butts. So I said, I'm going to cut my wrist. Somebody stole that when I was laying down and stole my wooden shoes, so that's what saved my life.
It's a long story, but we walked and made our way back to the main city. And we saw the trucks with the people from that camp being sent to the gas chambers. There was a person coming on a bicycle, and she asked me, is this a German or not? I had to be the eyes. I was 2 years old.
and I had to tell her if it was a German or not. Turned out to be somebody on a bicycle, a Frenchman, and he told us how to go to the city and what to do. And that's how we made it to the city. And we there found in Annecy some of the people who had all congregated in that place. And at least from my memory, I remember an attic where we all were sitting or almost laying down there. And the trucks from the camp with the people from the camp were moving in the street for the gas chambers. And we knew that if they heard there was a woman who one of her child was in those trucks, and if she cried too loud, we knew that we would be caught and taken too. So somebody was literally sitting on her to make sure that her cries will be stifled and not heard. And this is very vivid with me still.
From Auschwitz later, they took us in another place. We was working in a munition factory. And we was working, you know, with all this chemical and everything. And our lips was all became blue. We was inhaling, and our face was yellow. We was inhaling all this very strong chemical when I was working with that. Yeah. Matter of fact, when the elderly people used to come, and said, oh my God, who is these people? We come from the marsh? Because our lips was purple, our face was yellow, and our hair started to grow back because they cut out all our hair. It started to grow back, that was all like gold.
I was in Estonia, I was in Latvia, I was in, what do you call this, Riga, because the Germans kept very good records, and they sent me some papers because I was not known over in a camp by name, but I was known by a number. Anyway, they dragged us from one camp to the other one. To tell you what it happened in the camps is I myself don't believe it, the way we were persecuted, the way we were beaten for no reason at all. Hungry, lice, you know what lice is? Dirty. My fingers were a lot of, what do you call this, from dirt, it forms, what do you call this in English? It formed blisters. And by working, the only way what you could save yourself, if you worked, you found in a trash can a potato, a piece of bread or something, but you had to gobble this up that nobody should see it. So I did spend 4 years in all kinds of concentration camps. I don't know if you are familiar with cattle cars. We were taking from one, but sometimes they opened the cattle cart and they told us, if they didn't like somebody, to throw them out. Throw out those verfluchte Juden, you don't know what that means. Throw them out, it's not worthy to take him from one camp to the other one. I could talk to you for days and still not to understand, to make that something like that can happen, that one human being, a dog is better treated than we were treated.
And then they took us Germany to Auschwitz, and that is the worst concentration camp. That was really. And I said, oh boy, I said, in such a condition, such a situation, that is not life anymore. If they're going to last too long, they used to say, nobody will survive. You see, everybody was come to a good family, a nice home, good food, and they tried to make us happy. And then when everything changed, and everything got worse and worse, I said, uh-oh. Now we're just going to get it.
When I was working in a sawmill, I have a pass, so I could go out from the ghetto. But 3 blocks, you have to go around and go to the sawmill. So I could go in and out. We didn't know they could surrender the ghetto. So when I went out, and I was showing my pass, so I could go to the sawmill, and they says, the ghetto was already surrounded. And they said, no, you're not going back to the sawmill. And he hit me so hard in the back. He said, go back. Was a leather twisted pipe, like a stick or something. And he hit me so hard, so I didn't feel the pain. He said, you go back where you live. I went back over there and I told the family, I said, something going wrong. I couldn't go to work. Then I took off my shirts, all blood. Anyway, so I rest a little bit. I lay down. They put something on, you know, like the towel and everything. I was praying, I hope that I don't get killed by the Germans. Just survive. And telling the story, what I went through.
They counted who goes right, who goes left. My mother and my little brother and one sister perished in Stutthof. They took me to Kaufering. Kaufering is by Munich. Kaufering and Dachau was for men, and Kaufering was for women. And we were separated in Stutthof. My mother perished over there, my little brother perished over there.
We were caught again and we sent to a camp in southern France called Rivesalt, near the Spanish border in the Pyrenees Mountains. And we were there for some time till that camp was liberated. And then we were still in danger. And my mother managed to find a smuggler to smuggle us to Switzerland.
The typical day is you get up in the morning. We forget the breakfast because there you didn't have no breakfast. And they took you out to the place they think you're going to work that day. Till night, and then you went back to your cabin. You didn't have no chance to revolt. I mean, if you wanted to see tomorrow morning, you better do what they tell you.
But a person has something hiding, that says him the best that he could see in the face. The man has got something. So he walked up, pulled the man out from the line, searched his pockets and pulled out a gold watch, the gold chain. He took the carabine, hit him over the head, split his head down, and killed him on the spot. The rest of the guys, whatever they had, started throwing gold coins, rings, whatever chains they had. He stuffed his pockets with all this stuff, and walked out.
They stripped us the clothes, you know, they took everything away. They throw, like undershirts from paper. They throw clothes. Could be from other people, you know, the seat, you know, in guest chamber and everything. Shoes, they throw shoes. So somebody, like I have two shoes. One shoe was a small one, one was a big one. So you hollow. Who got a large shoe? I need a small one. Who need a small shoe? I have a large one. Anyway, three people didn't have no shoes. We have bunker beds. So somebody cut off from the, somehow they did, they broke off from the wood and the shoestrings and they tied up. And we have to stay every morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, like a, see how many people, the SS, how many people, if somebody died, not from hunger, so you have the dead person to bring him out. If he's dead, you have to lay here. So finally they find out two people don't have shoes. They have just the wood, for, you know, from the bunker beds. They ask us, who started? Who did with, you know? So we wouldn't say nothing. For if we would say, they would kill him. since we didn't say nothing, they said, tomorrow, you have to be out 6 o'clock with no shoes. Honest, no. So, in fact, my foot have still troubles. The leg got frozen.
My last concentration camp was Bergen-Belsen. Anne Frank died 3 weeks before liberation. I didn't know her. This was my last camp. But the beating and to see so many bodies in Bergen-Belsen piled up, they called this Muselman. Those they were so without food, you were so skinny, and without teeth, and just to look at the bodies, even if they would not beat you, even if they gave you something to eat, but just to see on the barracks, in the barracks, the way you slept on straw, and on the straw was a potato sack. You slept on a potato sack, and you slept straw under your dish, and they gave you one piece of bread, or they gave you soup. The soup consisted of bread soup. It was bread, but it was mostly water. Or potato soup, it was mostly water. Most of them died, most of them all died. In our this barracks, it was every day dead people, and we were ordered to throw them in the pile. At the beginning, they ordered us to dig ditches, but it was so many at the later years that you couldn't dig so many bodies to put in the ditches, so they let them just be piled up.
There was a few older people there. They used to tell me, listen, Edith, I know that for serve here, that's not like how your mother used to do with all these goodies. But make believe this is like a medicine. If you're sick and you are not taking the medication, you're going to die.
A few days ago, I read in the New York Times that the first prisoner in Auschwitz died at the age of 88. Just now, maybe 3-4 days ago. His number was 31. From 1 to 30, German criminal sadists were brought in to become trustees, capos. I came 3 years later. He was there, he arrived in June of 1940. I arrived in August of 1943. And my number is 139,996. 140,000 in between. 1,600,000 perished in the camp. Where's the difference between 31 and 140,000? They never got to the camp. They were gassed from the ramp to the gas chamber to the crematorium. Children. Mothers who would not let go of their children, grandmothers, grandfathers, anyone who was thought by Dr. Mengele, who made the selection, not to be fit for life, people who were broken down by years in the ghetto and work, all those were gassed. And we, who were in a camp, knew about that. Imagine the life of a young man, 25, 26, prime of life, who found out on the second day or third day that his wife and children were gassed and went up the chimney. They didn't live. They didn't want to live. in a camp, death was an option, and not a bad one. Some of us survived.
Working helped. They asked me what kind of beruf, that means what is my profession? I was a young child, what kind of profession did I have? But I always volunteered to work, so I always worked on a farm, and I was unloading sand, because they were building railways. And under the railways, you had to put sand under. Surviving, it was constantly in my mind, when my father dies in ghetto, and he tells me in Jewish, see that you should survive, you're the youngest one, to tell the story. And it kept me going. I said, I'm going to be okay. Because the sickness what existed in the camps was, what do you call this? Typhus. A lot of typhus was going on. Hungry, dirty, beating. You were beating unbelievable, unmercifully.
You had to be very resourceful. Was no way you could survive on the food they gave you. At most you could last is 10 days. Prisoners were lined up on three rows and with cracks in the boards. Some of the last days before the prisoner died, he couldn't eat the bread anymore. His stomach wouldn't take it. So I found out under the lower bunk where they kept the dead, because three bunks for the living, the concrete floor was where they stacked the dead. I went back there and found pieces of bread. The only thing was bad that the rats, the mice, got to it before me. So the piece of bread had holes in it. I didn't give a hoot how many holes it had. Whatever the rats didn't eat, I ate. And that kept me alive.
But you could not feel like a human there because it was just no place. Like I said, that just all you knew was go to work. In fact, when you had to wash your clothes, if it needed to, you sat in the bathroom, and then they gave it to you when it was finished, and you'd put them on. Sometimes all the ladies was there, and then sometimes all the men were there. Nobody looked at you as a woman, or you didn't look at those men sitting naked there as men. Just somebody, you know, didn't even pay no mind.
For us, they didn't give us nothing, almost. Coffee from chicory. And if you're lucky, you got some soup. You find a potato, you was lucky. They give us in the afternoon one slice of bread, a pan bread, for five people. I lost the family. I lost the whole family. Just one sister survived.
I was in Auschwitz for 6 weeks. After Auschwitz, I was sent to work in a factory, not far from the city of Breslau, then it's Wrocław, Poland. And I made 88 millimeter cannons for the Germans, for the firm Krupp. The factory was called Bertha Werk. I worked there for about a year. I was sent to two other camps, and then the war was over.
As you arrived in the dressing room, you were instructed to remove your clothes and shoes and leave them neatly where you could find them after your shower. The men and women were not separated when they undressed, which made them feel extremely uncomfortable. The Nazis had been very careful in their approach to this mass murder. They realized that if the people believed they were going to a shower, they would be a lot calmer, and it would not be a problem to get them to enter the gas chamber willingly. Guards herded in the people, and once inside, the door was slammed shut. It was then locked. The guards could observe from rear doors with warnings printed on them about the dangers of the gas. The people stood and waited for the water to flow from the shower heads in the ceiling. But instead, a guard poured Zyklon pellets into the vents on the roof. The Zyklon pellets were used originally as a disinfectant, but it was found to have the ideal properties needed to quickly and effectively murder large groups of people. The Zyklon worked as the gas chamber became warmer. As the temperature from the chamber full of people rose, the Zyklon pellets melted and turned to poisonous cyanide-based gas. Screams of terror filled the air as the people inside began to realize what was happening. You can only try to imagine the terror that was felt as the realization slowly dawned that they would never escape death in this sealed chamber. Many tried to claw at the walls to escape, and in some of the gas chambers you can still see scratch marks from people desperately trying to get out. After 20 minutes, the screams from the chamber were silent. The doors were then opened, and the bodies were dragged out. The inside of the gas chamber was then hosed down and prepared for the next arrivals. The Nazis had originally buried the victims in mass graves, but the bodies became too numerous and burial was very unsanitary. The rain and the swelling of the bodies made the earth break open. Therefore, the Nazis commissioned large crematoria ovens to be built. They then ordered many of the buried bodies to be exhumed for cremation. This also helped to disguise what was occurring at these camps. Piles of ash were easier to dispose of than a human body. The Nazis did not waste anything. When they came from the gas chambers, the bodies were searched for gold and hidden jewelry. Then the gold teeth were removed from their mouths by breaking their jaw, and they were melted down and taken to Reichsbank. Hair was also shaved and was stored in huge warehouses to be bundled and sold. It was eventually used to make matting for ships because of its waterproof qualities. Even after cremation, the Nazis utilized small bone fragments. Local farmers used the bones that did not completely disintegrate as fertilizer for the fields.
Well, we were liberated by the Soviets, and as soon as we felt the tanks rumbling, my father used to go at night with my uncle begging for food, so they used to go far out into the area with some of the farmers. One of the farmers had a shortwave radio. And my father said it was more important to listen to the news than it was even to get food. So he heard and was paying attention when the Americans opened the second front and when the Russians started pushing the push onto getting back Lithuania. And he knew that they were close at hand. So when we heard the tanks rumbling, we knew that the Russians had arrived, and we came out. And my father and I immediately went with the front lines while the combat was still going on to head back towards the ghetto, which by this time had been changed to a concentration camp. The difference from a ghetto and a concentration camp is that a ghetto is for the local populace. A concentration camp is when they start importing Jews from other areas. They killed enough of us off, there was room. So they started in 1943 to bring Jews into the ghetto, and they changed the name of the ghetto to a concentration camp. We were hoping that perhaps some of my father's family was still alive. When we got there, the Germans, when they took the Jews out to take them to concentration camps further in Germany, took gasoline and kerosene and dumped it on the houses and burned them, and took hand grenades and threw them into the brick homes. When they did so, they destroyed the whole ghetto. When we got there, the ghetto was still, or the concentration camp at this time, was on fire. We knew there was a hidden bunker that my father knew about, that if any of his family was alive, they'd be in that bunker. So we immediately headed for that bunker, and when we got there, on the ground outside the bunker, we found a ration card that belonged to my aunt, my father's sister. Inside was the burned body of a woman. She was burned beyond recognition. We don't know whether that was my aunt or not. We never saw her again. But because of the ration card, we knew that at one time or another she was there.
the Russian came in with little horses. The place where I used to be in the concentration camp was Russian occupied, came in. And they said, don't drink the water, don't eat nothing, but could be poison. And I want to go, they said, not far, are the American soldiers. So I have 82 pounds. How I walked, I don't know. So we went to American zones with the American soldiers. And I was glad. I was liberated. Thank God, God bless America.
When we came back to Belgium, first of all, we found out that there was nobody left in the family. My mother had a joint account with my father, who was at the time still considered missing. And in those days, a woman could not access a bank account without the signature of a husband. And the message in 1945 was very clear. Madame, we do not employ Jews here. And that was after the war, in 1945, in Antwerp. So my mother took a position as an instructor in the orphanage, in the Jewish orphanage in Antwerp. And she was responsible for the girls' group. But I had to be separate with the boys' group. And the discipline in those days was I couldn't talk to her, I couldn't do anything, only on her vacation days. The orphanage immigrated to Israel in 49, and that's when I reached Israel.
Oh, when they came with America, oh boy, God bless America. Everybody was happy. And I said, thanks God, they're going to save us.
And I was liberated from there, from Bergen-Belsen. Bergen-Belsen was a very big camp, and my future husband, he was 12 years older than I was, he came to look for his sisters, and he found two sisters, and he saw me, and he lived already. He was liberated before I was liberated. He was as a Polish man, with Polish people. The Polish people still had a little bit, they did not persecute that much, that bad, like they did the Jews. So he still had, they beat him up, he was blind in one eye, they beat him up the back, he was sick, we were married for 42 years, but he was sick the whole time.
In the middle of the night we had checks, because Teresa said I was a Czech. She was going around and said, long live, I think, banish or whatever the president was. And now, so we opened the windows, what happened? And they said, the war is over. Half the time, we didn't have any more guards. But there was no place to go. I was like 80 pounds. Hallelujah.
We chose life, but we felt guilty that we are here and our parents are not with us. And I was hoping that I'm going to go home, and I was still hoping that maybe somebody's in life. I went to Poland, but everybody was slaughtered.
We went on our way to Warsaw. From Warsaw, we went on to try to get to Czechoslovakia. They caught us at the Czech border, wouldn't let us cross, turned us back. And as they turned us back, my father saw a guide. There was an underground railroad going on for a lot of Jews trying to escape. The guide told us he couldn't take us, but if we went through the woods, we would end up in Berlin. Well, we had no compass. We didn't know where we were going, but my father wasn't going to just lay around. So he had a knapsack with clothes and food. Mother had a knapsack, and I had a knapsack with that same blanket, that down blanket that I was carrying. And we took off into the woods at night without any guidance, kept heading in the general direction where the guide told us to go. After a while, I couldn't go anymore. I told my parents, I said, I don't care what they do to me. I can't take another step. They can kill me. I don't care. I just hurt. I can't go. My mother grabbed my knapsack off of me, put it on her knapsack, My father grabbed me and put me on his knapsack on his shoulders, and we continued to go.
My sister, she was a year older than me, and she got sick, you know, she was sick from malnutrition. And when we got off, no, when we got on the tugboat, she was still alive. But she was not alive, you know. And the way, she was very hungry. She was that small. I mean, you could almost take her waist with one hand. And she died because she was hungry. Now, right there in the tugboat, you didn't have no place to sleep or anything, on the floor. And I laid her down and I said, you know, she said, why don't you put me in that bed? You know, she was talking like that. And finally, I made her a place to lay down. But she was hungry. Some guards cooked potatoes in the next compartment, and they peeled the potatoes a little bit heavier, and they gave it to a woman in my compartment. And I saw she had potatoes. I said, well, I have to go and ask, because I have to give her something in her mouth. And I went over there, I mean, maybe from here till the desk, and she said, and I said, what I want. Oh, if I had strength enough to go from here to there, I don't need potatoes. I say, it's not for me. I said, take a look, my sister right there, she cannot die for hunger. They gave me 8 pieces of pills, potato pills, and so help me God. I didn't put one in my mouth, as hungry as I was too. I gave it all to my sister.
My father saw a house with some lights on it. He went to it, knocked on the door. Out came a German in a pair of slacks, pants, boots on, and an insulated undershirt. My father told him we were lost. We were trying to get to East Berlin. Where were we? The guy said, just a minute. Closed the door. A few minutes later, which seemed forever, I don't know how many minutes it was, the guy came back dressed in full police uniform with a weapon. And it told us, come with me. My father whispered to me, he says, I guess we're caught. We'll have to see what happens. He took us to the border, told the guard to open up the border, and that's known in the movies, they use it as Checkpoint Charlie. I'm sure you've seen some of those spy things where they come over the bridge from East Berlin to West Berlin. Well, that was us. The German told him to open up, and he pointed across the other side of the bridge, he says, go there, you will be in West Berlin in the American zone. And they let us through.
Because we were still at high risk to be caught and sent to the gas chambers again. My father had been before us and he was taken and never came out. We managed to walk with a couple of families to the night to Switzerland. And there was a child who was younger than me, who was on the smuggler's bicycle back. There's like a luggage thing. It's metal. And the child was sitting on there, and I had the responsibility to make sure that if that child cried, that I would stuff something in his mouth so the dogs would not pick the noise and the scent. And we made it to the Swiss border. And there were trenches dug so people with wood, so people would fall and essentially break their neck when it was wet. And we went through those, and then I remember very clearly the Swiss soldier holding the barbed wire up for us to crawl through and to make it into Switzerland, and that was 1944. And I remember after that being in a station where they gave us tea, and he had a backpack where he was giving the tea with. And we were then put in camps in Switzerland, in refugee camps, under Swiss control. And I ended up the war in Switzerland was repatriated to Belgium in 1945.
I closed my eyes and I saw the barracks
and all these poor skinny people who have died already a longer time, and they couldn't eat that stuff, and they're all losing the weight and get so weak. You know, they give them a stick to help them to walk, because they were so weak already. When the American came and they give us the vitamin and the better food, they have to build them up to build back the life. The people were just wonderful. That's what they used to say, God bless America. They leave so many innocent people who suffered from the German for nothing, just because they were Jews.
First I was here. Then I told them, I don't want no charity. I want to go to get a job. So I went to Charlotte, North Carolina. I stayed over there about 6 or 8 months. Then I couldn't speak English in bus, no refugees like we are here, you know, from concentration camp. So I told them I came back to Richmond. Thank God. God bless America, I'm here.
I came here as a graduate student to finish my degrees, and I got a degree in biochemistry and then in virology at Boston University School of Medicine. And I'm a virologist and a professor at Medical College of Virginia in Richmond.
We were planning to go to Palestine. At that time was Palestine, not Israel. But my husband's sisters went to Palestine and they were writing us letters. Palestine is very bad. If you can sign up to go to America, go to America. So that's what we did. We signed up after the war. The Hebrew Benevolent Association were very helpful to help DP people. I was a DP. You know what's a DP? No. Displaced people. Or the joint. This was organizations that they tried to help us after the war.
I know that the moment I came to the United States, the day I turned 18, I volunteered for the military. I ended up with the rank of colonel. I've been active in community service for Jewish and non-Jewish organizations all my life.
Yes, a girl from the little skinny girl there. Yeah, that's what she was telling. Her name was Edith Alexander. That was me, a little skinny girl, yeah. So they came and she said, yeah, I am your cousin. Yeah, I heard about that. Tell me, I have a rich cousin in America. And then finally we come to America. I said, God bless America, wonderful country.
Well, somebody who survived that kind of thing had to be clever and lucky. Luck was more important. Anyone who was in the wrong place at the wrong time could not survive. If you were in the wrong line and that line was selected to the crematories, you were gone. But let's talk about the survivors who survived. Well, once you go to Auschwitz, you come to America, this truly, honestly, is a land to... You have no idea what it meant to me when I found out that if a policeman wants to come to my house, to my apartment, he has to have a warrant. What do you mean a warrant? He's a policeman. You have no idea what happened to me after I read the Constitution, the Magna Carta. We live in a world where a number of people, a great number of people, were dedicated to eliminating the Jews.
Life, freedom, and love. Love of your fellow men. I've been trying to teach about the horrors of the Holocaust. And I've tried to teach other people to be mindful of their neighbors. Frequently use an example. You can't like everybody, but you need to know why. You've got to know people. You've got to understand people. They could be the most wonderful, generous people in the world once you know them. Beauty is on the inside, not on the outside. If I cut my finger, and I cut the finger from a Chinese and a black, and let the blood drip into the glass, none of us can pick out our blood. It's all the same. You've got to give people an opportunity and not stereotype.
I pray for peace, and I hope people have the understanding. They learn from the Holocaust that it should never happen again.
When one injustice is done to one, is done to all. The Germans started the war with the Jews, but they did terrible things to priests and nuns and other people. I want them, people should never forget.
If I talk about, a whole year is not enough what I saw, what I went through. But you see, what is the problem? They bring me back too many bad memories.
We opened up a little grocery store, so we had for 25 years. And my children, my oldest son, became a doctor. And he lives here in Richmond. And my other son became a CPA. That's my pride and joy. And he has two children. And my daughter lives in Boston. And she married a doctor. And she never worked, but she's very educated. You see, in every household you have to have a good education.
I would love to want all to know that we are happy that we are alive and we are here. And we hope that people will be tolerant and care about each other and be kind to each other and to raise the children in good, to be kind and good to people.
You wouldn't believe it what I'm going through with 9/11, with Iraq. I am like back in the concentration camps because I am afraid this beautiful country that I love so much, you people were born always a silver spoon in your mouth. You don't know in other countries the way they live. When I left Poland, this is the best country in the world. It's not 100%, but it's 97-98% perfect, this country. And we all have to be vigilant who our leaders are, who our president is, and to really speak up and not to be afraid, like I'm afraid to speak up. I was afraid, but now I'm trying a little bit not to be afraid.
Hate has to be recognized for what it is. It's not the color of your coat, not what you eat, not your dress, not if you're blue, green, or yellow, or red. It's simply hate. And a two-year-old child doesn't know from anything. He doesn't know if he's Jewish, Christian, Muslim, Hindu. He doesn't know. All what he's a child knows is a child. And to go after a child because he's born in this world to a special place or family or whatever, can only be explained on hate.
When I go back to Auschwitz today, to my camp, which still stands, the quarantine camp in Birkenau, my barracks still stands, I cannot possibly conceive what went on there, and yet I know what went on. We were always hungry, we were always sick. In the factory where we worked, we were less than slaves. Slaves are property. Slaves have value. We were like sandpaper. Rub us once or twice, useless, throw it in the garbage and burn it. That was life in camp. I can't tell you anything else because it is not something that even we survivors can deal with it.
I always wanted to have kids because we lost so much. We lost so much. We had no one. And I had, thank God, I had fortune, wonderful kids. I have to say that's my pride and joy. That's what I have to tell you. I've got, if I have to brag, I've got two sons, doctors.
One is oncologist and one is head and neck surgeon. My oldest one is 52, my baby is 33. Two sons and two daughters.
My late mother was a very wise woman, an optimistic person. And she said to me, let's not dwell on the trouble. Let's live.
Let's hope it never happens again.
We could sit here for hours. We just highlighted and skimmed of the experience of what happened. But I still have my down blanket, and it's on my bed.
If somebody say it was not the Holocaust, how they could say, I'm living survival. I went through the Holocaust and hope and live. Never will happen again.
Future Nobel Prize winners, scientists, athletes, doctors, lawyers, philanthropists, all put to death because of the lunatic obsession of one evil, crazy man and his followers. If there is a bright spot to this dark time in history, it is that some were spared. Dr. Roger Loria was such a survivor, and today he will impact the world with his contribution.
You feel you have a responsibility. I do. I am the only survivor of my family. And you ask always the question, why? Why you? What did you do? What do you do in this planet? And my philosophy is to try to find things, to discover things, or to develop some new knowledge. And I have been able to do that. I've been lucky and blessed to do that. And one of the new drugs I discovered will be used for protection against lethal radiation. Above the Hiroshima dose, we can protect a dose which killed 100% of people in Hiroshima. We can protect today with this new drug. And it should be available this year to the Department of Defense and to the US Army.
I worked in a factory. I also worked in a factory when I came to the States. The most important piece of property in a factory is the man operating the machine. For should he not know how to operate it, he'll break it. Or he'll produce scrap. More people died in Fünfteichen at Krupp, and it's documented, than live to operate the machinery. I'll tell you another thing, but it's off the subject of what we have in common. We survived, I cannot tell you. Towards the end of the war, that factory had approximately 6,000 prisoners, concentration camp inmates, many Germans. The Germans, most of them were older people because their sons were either dead or on the front. And these were people who remember the end of the First World War. There was no doubt in their mind, after Stalingrad, after Al-Alamein, after the Allies landed, that this is not going to turn out as good as the Fuhrer thought it would. So they looked at us. 60% of the prisoners were Russian prisoners of war, victorious and approaching the German border. And here they were beaten and starved to death. What a situation. Can you imagine this? Now, I'll tell you the greatest thing that happened after the war. We never killed anybody. You couldn't give me $1 million to scratch a German child. Talk to any survivor. They were crazy. We were not. That's all I have to say.
Here's to our prosperity, our good health and happiness, and most important, to life, L'chaim. L'chaim, l'chaim to life. Here's to the father I try to be.
Here's to my bride-to-be.
Drink l'chaim to life, l'chaim. L'chaim, l'chaim to life. Life has a way of confusing us,
blessing and bruising us.
Drink l'chaim to life. God would like us to be joyful, even when our hearts lie panting on the floor.
How much more can we be joyful when there's really something to be joyful for?
To life, l'chaim. To title my daughter,
my wife. It gives you something to think about,
something to drink about. Drink l'chaim to life.
Le Morcha.
Yes, Lizzie.
Drinks for everybody.
What's the occasion?
I'm taking myself a bride.
Who is it?
Tevye's eldest psych.
To Lizzie Wolf. To Tevye.
To title your daughter.
My wife.
May all your futures be pleasant ones, not like our present ones. L'chaim to life, l'chaim. L'chaim, l'chaim to life. It takes a wedding to make us say, let's live another day. Drink l'chaim to life. We'll raise a glass and sip a drop of schnapps in honor of the great good luck and favor of you. We know that when good fortune favors too, such men it stands to reason, we deserve it too.
But I'm still here.
If you would like to know more about the Holocaust, please visit the Virginia Holocaust Museum on 2000 East Cary Street, Richmond, Virginia. You can reach them by telephone at area code 804-257-5400 or by email at www.virginia.holocaust.com.